my talk at the upcoming ESMO Breast, I will give a comprehensive portrait on the current state of knowledge on patient selection for breast cancer therapy based on biomarkers. We'll start from immunohistochemical based biomarkers. That is to say, the traditional estrogen receptor, progesterone receptor, and HER2, cutting-edge molecular biomarkers, such as those that can be identified with sequencing, next-generation sequencing, and gene expression profiling. So the issue in patient selection for breast cancer is based on the observation that even though the traditional biomarker assessment is extremely useful and has granted the improvement in survival for this patient, there are still subset of patients that experience tumor progression. So we now know that the traditional biomarker assessment is changing day by day. So we now know that estrogen receptor positive breast cancer are completely different kind of tumors compared to estrogen receptor negative. But among estrogen receptor positive breast cancer, we have a subset of patients that accounts for approximately 1 to 10%, 2 to 3%, that express estrogen receptor at low levels. The low level of estrogen receptor expression is less than 10%. So these tumors are clinically challenging because we have only limited data on the benefit of endocrine therapies breast cancer, but they're still eligible for endocrine treatment. So from the gene expression profiling studies, we now know that these tumors are more similar to estrogen receptor negative tumors. But the clinical issue is how to identify this patient, because they are extremely challenging from the diagnostic point of view. And the estrogen receptor expression is based on immunohistochemistry, but the expression of these tumors in terms of estrogen receptor is usually weak to very weak. And so there are many issues related to preanalytical and analytical characteristics. So preanalytical fixation can affect the staining, but also there's a low intracellular reproducibility. So for this reason, the new the updated ASCO-CAP recommendation suggests to provide an additional comment in the pathology report for this patient. So that's why estrogen receptor low is still an exciting field of research because of its clinical repercussions. Moving to another crucial biomarker in breast cancer therapy, we have HER2. So until now, we know that HER2 positive breast cancer can benefit to specific treatments such as anti-HER2 therapies. But among these tumors that account for approximately 15 to 20%, there are issues of intra-tumor heterogeneity, in which HER2 is expressed differentially in different areas from of the tumors. You can have a cluster heterogeneity or a mosaic heterogeneity or even a scattered heterogeneity in which you have isolated have 2+ cells within an 2 negative tumors. These HER2 heterogeneous tumor account for up to 2% of breast cancer. That it's a remarkable number of patients given the clinical challenges that they provide. Indeed, we know that they have a poorer prognosis compared to HER2 negative tumors. And also, we still don't know how this intratumor heterogeneity can affect the therapy of this patient. So at the end, again, HER2 is an extremely important field of study for breast cancer. And akin for estrogen receptor, we have a subset of tumors. There is better to define as a spectrum of HER2 positive tumors that are the HER2 low invasive breast cancer. These tumors account for approximately half of all invasive breast cancer. And they display a low degree of HER2 expression. So they range from HER2 1+ at immunohistochemistry to 2+ with in situ hybridization negative result. So at present, we have several clinical trials trying to identify patients that can benefit from specific anti-HER2 drugs, such as duocarmazine or deruxtecan, that have shown encouraging response rate in HER2 low breast cancer. But again, this field of study is continuously evolving. And so the way and the road to precision medicine for this patient is still some new places where to lead us. And another important biomarker that I will touch in my presentation is the PD-L1, the programmed death ligand 1, that is expressed in approximately 4 to 60% of triple negative breast cancer, and its expression is restricted to the immune cells. Now we know that PD-L1 positive invasive breast cancer can benefit from atezolizumab therapy, that is an anti-PD-L1 drug. But also we know that from the IMPASSION study, IMPASSION 130 study, that atezolizumab plus nab-paclitaxel has prolonged the progression-free survival in PD-L1 positive triple negative breast cancer. So the point is how to identify this patient. For breast cancer, we are extremely lucky because we have tumor-specific guidelines for PD-L1 assessment with a companion diagnostic assay. So atezolizumab therapy came with a companion diagnostic assay that is the PD-L1 clone SP142 that demonstrates staining in tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes mainly and not in the and only occasional in the tumor cell. So the specific guideline for PD-L1 immunohistochemistry interpretation in breast cancer are based on the count of tumor-infiltrating immune cells that express PD-L1 on the membrane. This is called IC score. So again, tumor-infiltrating lymphocyte should be routinely evaluated in triple-negative breast cancer. So that's another crucial point that from Sangal in 2019, we now know that these analyses should be performed in all triple-negative breast cancer. And also for tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes, despite the PD-L1 expression, we have a specific guideline for their assessment, particularly for the stromal tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes that are prognostic in triple negative breast cancer and HER2 positive breast cancer. We still don't know about the prognostic value in estrogen receptor positive breast cancer. They seem to have no prognostic value in this subset of patients. But immunotherapy in breast cancer is not only approved in PD-L1 positive breast cancer. We have other biomarkers for patient selection, such as the mismatch repair system and the presence of microsatellite instability. Indeed, the Food and Drug Administration have approved another immunotherapeutic drug, such as that is called pembrolizumab. It's an anti-PD-1 drug in all tumors that show mismatch repair deficiency and or microsatellite instability high. And that was quite a revolution in cancer therapy, because it was the first histology agnostic approval, meaning that all tumors that show this specific alteration are eligible for pembrolizumab therapy, including breast cancer. So the point is how to select patients for pembrolizumab therapy, breast cancer patients in particular. We know that we have this alteration to look at, but do we have tumor-specific guidelines? Not yet at present, not yet. But the scientific community is working on that. In my presentation, I will also talk about the multigene test that we still don't know if they are more prognostic or more predictive. There are several of these multigene tests, and they give complementary information, particularly in estrogen receptor positive breast cancer. And they may help informing for chemotherapy decision in estrogen receptor positive HER2 negative breast cancer, and they have been approved in several countries worldwide, including most of the European countries. Another biomarker that we'll talk about in my lecture would be PI3 kinase. That is a quite important biomarker because activating mutation PI3 kinase occur in a substantial proportion of estrogen receptor positive HER2 negative breast cancer, and they can be analyzed using specific assays. They are real-time PCR-based assays. We have a companion diagnostic also for that. The SOLAR-1 trial showed that tumors with PI3 kinase mutant estrogen receptor positive and HER2 negative show longer progression-free survival and greater response to alpelisib and fulvestrant than placebo and fulvestrant therapy. So alpelisib is a selective inhibitor of PI3K alpha, works and performs really well in this subset of patients. But again, we should always take into account the resistance phenomenon to this therapy that in breast cancer can be related to alterations in P10 and estrogen receptor 1 genes. Other important biomarker for patient selection that I will focus on my lecture will be BRCA1 and 2, and in particular for their role as predictive of response to PARP inhibitor therapy. Such as olaparib, in particular olaparib. We know that tumors that show BRCA alteration in the BRCA genes, are eligible to these therapies because of synthetic lethality phenomena, meaning that PARP can be inhibited and can lead to cell death in patients showing BRCA alterations, because BRCA cannot supply to the loss of function of PARP due to its inhibition. Other important biomarker that I will talk about in my presentation will be those that another important histology agnostic biomarker that is NTRK. We know that NTRK altered tumors can be eligible to specific target therapies. But again, NTRK fusions occur only in a minority of breast cancer. But these tumors, are eligible to tyrosine TRK inhibitors. That and that's why it's extremely important to be able to identify them. We can use in situ hybridization tools, or we can use immunohistochemistry. Again, we have several tests, including complementary and companion diagnostic tests, that can be employed in these settings. That's more or less the overview that I will provide in my lecture on the upcoming ESMO Breast.